What's up, boxing fans? I'm Michael Montero for Boxing Monthly, and you're watching A Neutral Corner for the week of March 26th. All right, so lots going on in the boxing world, a lot of news and notes, so let's get right into the ring walk. If you haven't already heard, Thomas Hauser, one of the more respected, experienced boxing reporters out there, a real boxing journalist, has put together a five-part series called What We Know About Al Haymon. And Ring TV, the website for Ring Magazine, they are releasing each of the five parts every day this week. So far I've already read two out of the five. Today the second part was released. And you know, for me, so far, there really hasn't been any new information, but I think for a lot of boxing fans, particularly people who have gotten into the sport, let's say within the last 5 years or so, there's going to be a lot of new information for you guys. And one thing Thomas Hauser is very good at doing is taking little bits of information from this story, little bits from that story, and just putting it all together in one place. And that's how it kind of goes with Al Haymon, right? Because he doesn't do interviews. Very, very secretive about his business. Everybody really, really close to him is ultra secretive too. He only has a few people that are really, really close to him that pretty much handle things in the public eye for him. And those are basically like his consiglieres. Like they're like people that he trusts with his life. Everybody outside of that, he's pretty much a ghost, right? So what Hauser's done is taken just little bits of things that people have heard over the years, little sound bites, little chunks of stories, put it all together in one place. Highly recommend that you check this out. I think it's mandatory reading for any of you guys out there that are trying to do a YouTube page or a Twitter page or some kind of social media boxing chat room or something like that. You young guys that are new to the sport, don't really know the business behind the business that I try to talk about sometimes. Highly recommend reading that piece. You know, I won't go into a big thing on Al Haymon here, but you know, my overall opinion of Al is just that he is a control freak. He's just a crazy, crazy, crazy control freak. And I think that's why he's so secretive with the media. He likes to control what people know and what they don't know. And that's why when you see a lot of fighters sign with Al, all of a sudden their Twitter accounts change, all their social media changes, the way they talk to the media changes, their accessibility goes away, because he doesn't just sign management deals with just the boxing aspect of your career. He basically manages everything, every single aspect of your career. And you know, there's supposed to be a difference between a manager and a promoter. And just like in the entertainment industry, there's, you know, you can have a manager and an agent. It's kind of the same thing. I have a manager that handles all my stuff with in my, you know, entertainment work. And you know, I'm very, very familiar with the way management contracts work. They're a little different in boxing, but it's still the entertainment business, basically. And you're still working in that function. And I think what Hauser's piece is ultimately going to do is divulge some of the stuff where a lot of people think Al Haymon is kind of breaking the rules a little bit, kind of, you know, stepping over the line from manager to promoter, which violates the Ali Act and other smaller rules. Some of them are state specific, but some of them are nationwide. And not just that, just give some general background. So anyway, check that out. Very, very interesting piece. And you know, right when you open up the article, there's a picture of Al Haymon in Harvard, and it's a picture that a lot of you have probably never seen. So that right there is worth the click. But other news this week, let's get on to some fighter news, right? Lucas Brown, who just won the WBA whatever the fuck title in Chechnya a couple weeks back against Ruslan Chagaev, tested positive for a tributyrol, I think is how you say it. A drug that is known in bodybuilding circles to help with your endurance. It's kind of, it just gives you a pep. It kind of gives you energy for a few hours, I think. And it's supposed to help with your endurance and help with your recovery. So you could go a little bit longer in the weight room, you recover a little faster. And he tested positive for that. And look, VADA, The only testing agency that I actually support and believe in the entire world, they did the testing. Now, Lucas Brown and his team are completely denying that they did anything wrong. In full disclosure, tributyrol is a substance that has been linked many times for guys that, you know, popped for that drug on the test, linked to like tainted meat, I think bronchial inhalers for people who have asthma. They've tested positive for it. So there could be some contamination of the results. Also, look, there's a lot of conspiracy theory out there that maybe somebody there in Russia messed with the test results or something, or contaminated things before VADA got to check it out. I don't know. We need some details to emerge from the folks at VADA who stand by their test results, and of course from Lucas Brown's camp. I don't know what's going to come from this, but you got to remember, Ruslan Chagaev has fought for a version of the WBA heavyweight title a billion times. Fresno Kendo is tied up the WBA in court. He's supposed to get a crack at that belt next. So what happens if the WBA in their infinite wisdom demands a Brown-Chagaev rematch, and then the winner of that fights Fresno Kendo or something? Man, I hope it doesn't go to that. Don't want to jump to conclusions about Lucas Brown, but look, he did show very good recovery in that fight. Getting up from a knockdown, he was badly hurt. I can't remember what round it was, but it was later in the fight. Middle rounds, later rounds. And then he had a little surge late in that fight. And, well, Chagaev was getting tired. And look, Chagaev was fat, you know, out of shape. But for Brown, I mean, it kind of fits the characteristics. I'm not trying to throw shade or anything like that. But, you know, just got to keep it real. We'll see. Maybe this is all just, you know, a contaminated meat thing. It's possible. But we need more details before we, you know, try to throw this guy's feet to the fire or anything like that. More news. Let's see. Yuriorkis Gamboa just signed with BB Promotions, a new promotional outfit out of Spain. So a Cuban guy who defected to the United States is now signed with a new promoter in Spain. Now, here's the thing. You guys remember Gamboa signed with 50 Cent's promotional company, which is now bankrupt. But as I understand it, 50 Cent's company still has rights on Gamboa, even though he's bankrupt and everything, the way the contract is written out. So I think as part of this deal with BB Promotions, who I've never heard of, obviously they're a startup, I think 50 Cent still gets his cut of Gamboa's future fights. So even though he's going to be fighting for this this new outfit, I think a slice of that, you know, maybe 50 Cent of each fight goes to 50 Cent. I don't know, but that's the way I understand it. Man, Gamboa, just what a weird career. Some of these guys, him, Gamboa, there's been several of these Cuban guys that have just made really strange business deals. And I shouldn't just say it's just the Cuban guys, but you know, there's several American fighters who have made weird business decisions. But man, just a couple of these Cuban guys in recent years just stand out in my mind. You got a guy like, you know, Luis Ortiz, who signed with Golden Boy, very, very smart. Now he's fighting on HBO, and you know, his title shot, full title shot, is looming. But some of these other guys, man, it's just hard to understand the business moves they make. You know, it's just like, who is managing these careers? I don't know. But, other news. The Canelo undercard. You see what I did there? Amir Khan and Canelo. Canelo. Yeah. The undercard is announced, and I'm sure you guys out there know, but for those of you who don't know, David Lemieux is taking on Glenn Tapia in, I believe, a middleweight fight, but they haven't announced that. So we don't know for sure what the weight's going to be, and given that Lemieux just missed weight, makes me wonder. It also makes me wonder, did he miss weight on purpose because he had this fight coming up? Some more conspiracy theory, I don't know. But Glenn Tapia, look, man, he got just killed by James Kirkland a couple years back, right? I want to say that was in Atlantic City. I want to say Steve Smolger was the ref. And Steve Smolger is probably my favorite ref of this generation. He really failed on that night because Tapia was out on the ropes and Smolger did not jump in time. And Kirkland, because it's just kind of his nature, the way Ann Wolf taught him, he will beat the shit out of a corpse until somebody pulls him off. Okay, that's just how he is. I've seen him sparring guys, knocking them the fuck out and continuously pounding on them on the ropes. Say what you will about it, I think it's disgusting. That's the way the guy fights. And he was just pounding Tapia 2, 3, 4 shots after he was knocked out. And Smoger should have jumped in. And I just remember thinking that night that those extra few shots did Tapia for good. Just never going to be the same after that. And he hasn't been. That being said, if Lemieux has trouble, if this fight is at 160 and Lemieux has trouble making that weight limit, you know, maybe Tapia's got a shot. Either way, that's going to be a really, really fun fight. Somebody's getting knocked the hell out. Also on that card, Patrick Teixeira taking on Curtis Stevens. For those of you who are not familiar with Patrick Teixeira, I've seen him up close. He was at an LA Fight Club card last October. He's a nice guy to watch, a nice young prospect coming up. Tall, 5'11", southpaw, only 25 years old, 26-0, 22 knockouts. You compare that to Curtis Stevens, right? Curtis Stevens is 5'7", compact, power-punching guy. He's definitely more powerful than Teixeira. But Teixeira is a volume puncher, and he does punch with pretty good leverage. Stevens is 31, hasn't fought since October 2014, since he lost by decision to Hassam Nandam in Santa Monica. I was ringside for that fight, too. I was ringside for both of these guys' last fights. Given what I saw, you know, ringside for both of those, I got to pick Teixeira here. But Stevens is going to put some leather on him early. And we're going to see how for real Teixeira is. He's a Brazilian prospect. So far, he's looked good. You know, showing a good chin. I saw him eat leather in the fights I've seen him in. And can he take a shot from Curtis Stevens? Because one thing that Stevens does have is a nasty punch. So that's going to be a fun fight too. I look for Stevens to possibly buzz or maybe even drop Teixeira. And if Teixeira is the real deal early on, I think he gets up from that knockdown, works his way back into the fight, and he stops Stevens down the stretch. That fight could steal the show. The other fight is Frankie Gomez going up against Mauricio Herrera. And, you know, I was excited for this one at first. I'm less excited about it now, just thinking about the styles. Herrera is, well, you guys know his career. You know, he's been robbed a few times. And I'm glad he's getting this opportunity. He deserves it. 35 years old, right? He's 5'7", 71-inch reach, going up against Gomez, who's only 24. He's 5'8", 70-inch reach. So size-wise, these guys match up well. But one is a young kid who's that size. One is a grown man who's that size, right? So Gomez is going to get bigger. He's the naturally bigger guy, I think, in that respect. Naturally stronger guy. Plus, in 27 pro fights, Herrera only has 7 KOs. In 20 pro fights, Gomez has 13 KOs. He's the stronger guy. For Gomez, you know, when he turned pro, a lot of people saw him as a blue chip prospect. I think he turned pro in 2010. Got off to a very, very fast start. A lot of people were very excited about him, especially here in the LA area. He's from East LA. And he had some problems. He had a lot of problems early in his career. And he's one of those guys where he's got to get right in the head. And we got to see if he's really, really focused on this 100%, this boxing thing. This is a massive, massive opportunity for him. He can't screw this up. Also this week, more developments with Thurman Porter. They're talking about June 25th at Barclays. Again, more conspiracy theory. I guess each of the neutral corner is going to have, you know, a theme. Last week it was the negative corner. This week it's the neutral conspiracy theory. You know, look, Thurman was in a car accident and there's been absolutely no proof of this accident made public at all. And they were fighting at a small venue in Connecticut, I want to say, a small casino in Connecticut. And now they're talking about doing this June 25th at Barclays in Brooklyn, right? Which is a much better venue, a pretty good boxing venue. It's kind of turning into the StubHub Center of the East Coast. Not there yet, but it's getting there. Bigger venue, better date, you know? So, hey, you know, I don't know. Sometimes some things go on behind the scenes to, you know, push the fight to a better time and date and place. One other thing, Well, two other things, and then we'll get into the fight reviews of last week. Lomachenko has agreed to terms with Bob Arum. Nicholas Walters wants more money. Now, this fight's been agreed to, as I understand it, at 130 pounds. So Lomachenko has kind of made a concession in that regard. He's going up in weight so that Walters can be comfortable. Walters is demanding a career high payday. I think he wants more than three times what he's been paid. He wants over $1 million. And I think the most he's ever made is about 300, 350 grand. So he's asking for a much, much bigger purse than he's ever had. And, you know, look, he's holding this thing up, man. Some of these fighters now, again, you got to be willing to take a pay cut sometimes to get the big opportunity to get you to that next level. And for Walters, this is that opportunity, man. He's going to be the bigger guy, the bigger puncher. If he knocks off Lomachenko, and this is at 130 pounds, where he's got a very good chance of doing that, he suddenly becomes a big, big player. Because unlike Lomachenko, Walters speaks English and he speaks Spanish. That makes him so much more marketable to mainstream fans than Lomachenko. You think about that. Bob Arum has gone on record saying that he plans to lose about 200 grand on this card, paying out what he wants to pay everyone. But with what Walters wants, he'd lose significantly more. And he's only willing to lose 100, 200 grand on this. So Walters needs to make a concession here, take a little bit less money so that we can get this damn fight. Another fight closer to being made is Terrence Crawford, Victor Postol for July 23rd, probably in Las Vegas. And Jesse Vargas would probably be in a co-feature. I didn't think this fight was going to happen until the fall. So, hey, if this thing happens and that ends up being the summer pay-per-view that Bob Arum was talking about for Terrence Crawford, that's not a bad deal, okay? This fight should be on regular HBO, don't get it twisted, but at least it's not Crawford versus Thierry Jean or something like that. If we get Crawford Postol in Vegas, and, you know, Jesse Vargas in his first title defense and a couple other good fights on the undercard, if it's priced at 50 bucks, it's not so bad. There's a little silver lining there. The one concession, Postol does not want the fight to be in Omaha. He doesn't want it in Omaha. And Crawford and his people, to their credit, were like, okay, cool. So if they do it in Vegas, they'll get a site fee from a casino and everything else. I know Arum wanted to bring Crawford out here to LA this summer, but I just think in the end, this thing's going to Vegas. So that's it for news and notes this week. Let's get into the review of last week's action. Last Friday in Philadelphia, undefeated Philly prospect Jesse Hart survives an early knockdown, dropped in the first round, to score a unanimous decision over Deshaun Johnson. Look, I told you guys last week, Deshaun Johnson is one of those guys with a shitty looking record, but he's better than his record suggests. He's been in there with a lot of up and coming prospects. He's kind of seen a lot of guys like Jesse Hart over the years. So, you know, some people are making a big deal of this knockdown. You know, look, this fight wasn't televised, so it's kind of just out there in the Twitter sphere, people talking about it. I'm not gonna panic over this. Hart is a prospect. He got dropped by a guy who is experienced, who has been in there with other prospects and tried to upset them before. Prospects get dropped sometimes. This is boxing. For an undefeated guy to get dropped in the first round, recover, and coast down the stretch and win the fight, you would have liked it if he closed the show and he didn't. But he responded fairly well. I mean, think about that. You know, the mentality of an undefeated guy. It's not like he got dropped in the seventh or eighth round. It was the first freaking round to recover, rebound, and essentially control the fight. You know, through, I think it was the 10 rounder. You know, look, that's a good learning lesson for Hart. So let's not jump jump the gun and say, oh, this guy's trash. You know, he's overrated. That was all the action really of note Friday. Saturday in Houston, I talked about that comeback card. Juan Diaz scored a TKO. Mike Alvarado scored a KO, both over, you know, cab drivers, you know, so it's not even worth really going into. For Juan Diaz, he hasn't taken that much punishment in his career, so maybe he can work himself into a title shot. I don't know. Maybe not a title shot, but maybe a high-profile kind of fight against an up-and-coming fighter. You know, for Mike Alvarado, I just don't see him being in a title shot or anything like that again. I see him being in more of a farewell fight type of scenario, maybe next year or something. Maybe he'll just get a couple of stay busy fights like this while he kind of proves himself again to the promoters and stuff. But maybe he can work himself into a farewell kind of fight back in Denver to redeem himself with his hometown fans who were so disappointed last January with what happened, that whole, you know, rubber match with Brandon Rios. You know, maybe something like that. And maybe if he proves himself, you know, in these off-air fights, at least off the big networks, maybe he can work himself into a HBO card, if it's a double header, a triple header, you know, something where he's a co-feature. Maybe. That's all I really see with those two guys. Esquiva Falco, the undefeated Brazilian middleweight, he scored a KO too. He's now 13-0 with 10 knockouts. A prospect at middleweight to keep your eye on. We got a few guys, middleweight, super middleweight, coming up now that are real interesting. And I think over the next couple years, they're going to start challenging for titles and heat those divisions up a little bit more. They could use it. For Falco, it's interesting. His older brother, Yamaguchi Falco, who that's actually who I used to watch fight in the World Series of Boxing here in Los Angeles. He's the older brother, but he has less professional fights. So I don't know what's going on with him, but he's a light heavyweight. These two Falco brothers keep fighting and build themselves up. I mean, you'd think that they could kind of, I'm not gonna say like a Klitschko brother or Marquez brother thing, I'm not putting them in that esteem yet, but they should be fighting on the same cards, you know? I just don't understand what the business model is right there with those two guys. They should be kind of a 1-2 combo. They're brothers. They should be fighting together, or at least close together. But that doesn't seem to be the way their careers are going. It's kind of strange. That's it for last week's action. Let's look at this week's action coming up. So we get another Friday night card, this Friday the 25th at Fantasy Springs Casino here in Los Angeles. Antonio Orozco is going up against Miguel Acosta of Venezuela. For Orozco, he's 23-0, 15 knockouts, undefeated welterweight prospect. You might remember his last fight, he beat Humberto Soto last October by unanimous decision. I was ringside for that one. It was a real good learning lesson and a real step up for him. And I kind of see this as a big step down. To not fight since then and to take this step down. Look, Orozco took some leather and lost some rounds in that fight, but it was to Humberto Soto, a guy who's very experienced. And I thought Orozco overall looked good and learned on the job. But maybe the promoter or the manager just saw something they didn't like, because they're just stepping him down, man. Acosta's lost four in a row from 2011 to 2015. So he's only fought four times in the last 4 years, and he's lost all of them. So I just don't get this matchmaking, you know? Why are you taking such a big step down after that big step up last year? Jason Quigley, undefeated Irish middleweight, 9-0 with 8 knockouts. This is his first fight of 2016. He also fights on the card. You look, another middleweight prospect, and you know, can make things interesting over the next couple years, kind of take over the Andy Lee spot. And the thing with Quigley versus Andy Lee is Andy Lee's super nice dude, super great, super humble guy, but Quigley just has a bigger personality. He just seems to get it as far as doing interviews and working with the media. He's a young, good-looking guy, very articulate, handles himself well on camera. I kind of see him as a guy like a Joseph Diaz Jr., who I'll talk about in just a minute, just kind of gets it, you know? Just, I don't know how else to put it. Just in regards to how you deal with the media, how you speak, how you conduct yourself on camera. Quigley seems to be in that kind of mold as well. Also, Friday in Oklahoma at a little casino, not even the main event, somewhere down the undercard, Willie Nelson getting back in the ring since the big upset knockout over Tony Harrison last July. You guys remember, I've complained about this on a few episodes of TNC. He finally gets back in the ring against Jonathan Batista, a 15-8 fighter on this little card. As far as I know, it's not televised. I don't know anything about it other than that. I just think that this is very, very disappointing that it took this long to get Willie Nelson back in the ring after what was presumably the biggest win of his career. and at least at this stage of his career. And you know, this is what he gets. I don't know, man. But Saturday at Wembley Arena in London, Chris Eubank Jr. fights Nick Blackwell. Nick Blackwell is the British middleweight title. And for Eubank Jr., look, he's 3-0 since the close loss to Billy Joe Saunders. And the Saunders people have talked about possibly fighting Golovkin this summer or something like that. I don't know. If Chris Eubank Jr. wins this fight, which I expect he will, a rematch between Saunders and Eubank, that's big business over there in the UK. I wouldn't be surprised if Saunders is ringside for this fight Saturday. So it'll be interesting to see if Eubank Jr. calls out Saunders after this fight, you know, because I favor him heavily, as all you guys do too, I'm sure. But on the undercard of this fight, Huey Fury, related to Tyson Fury, right? The current legitimate heavyweight champion of the world, the guy on the cover of Boxing Monthly right here. 18-0, 10 knockouts. He's only 21 going up against Dominic Gwynn. Remember him, man? Dominic Gwynn. Just a perennial contender. Just been around forever. I want to say he's like 41, 42 years old right now. It's hard to think, you know, because he was kind of coming up when I was like really, really getting started in writing and boxing and stuff. You know, he was a contender. So just thinking that he's that age now, it's like, holy shit. I'm getting old. But Gwynn has lost 4 of his last 6. But here's the thing. Gwynn has been in with everybody. He's fought a who's who of heavyweight contenders over the last decade plus. Never been knocked out. Never been stopped. If Huey Fury can put some leather on him and stop him, that's a statement. From a 21-year-old, that's a statement. Here's the thing. His team is very, very confident because they have a date of 4:30 versus TBA for Huey Fury. So obviously, they're very, very confident going into this fight. But those are going to be two fun matchups, I think, for the fans there at Wembley. Staying in the UK, but going over to the Sheffield Arena in Yorkshire, Kell Brook. Where you been, Kell? Where you been, Special K? He's going up against Kevin Bizier of Canada. Look, Kell Brook's another guy. It's kind of disappointing. You know, he beat Sean Porter last August. And since then, this will be his third fight. The opposition just hasn't been very, very good. You know, you can kind of compare it to Terence Crawford after that big win over Gamboa. I do think overall, Terence Crawford's opponents have been better than Kell Brook's. And Terence Crawford's been a little busier. And just really putting a stamp on his victories and being more exciting. Brook, I don't know, man. I don't know what they're doing with this guy. But you got a guy here who's legitimately one of the best welterweights on earth. What I want to see here is Brook win big, exciting, score a knockout. Get rid of the Canadian. Don't screw around. And then after the fight, call out the Thurman Porter winner. Call out some of these PBC guys and say, look, I already came to the States and beat Sean Porter. If Sean Porter beats Keith Thurman, I'll go back to the States and beat him again. If Keith Thurman beats Sean Porter, I'll beat him like I beat Porter. That's the kind of language, that's the kind of rhetoric I want to hear from Kell Brook. He needs to get his career going, okay? It's in slow motion right now. On to the biggest card of the weekend in Oakland, California at the Oracle Arena. Andre Ward faces Sullivan Barrera in a light heavyweight fight. No catchweights here. A full 175. And the co-feature, Joseph Diaz, makes his HBO debut against Jason Velez. Let's start with the co-feature. Joseph Diaz, my prospect of the year last year in 2015. A guy that I've seen fight many, many times at the LA Fight Club cards, at Belasco. A guy that Golden Boy Promotions has brought up the right way. I want to say he had, dozens of rounds last year. I can't remember the exact number. But the guy got in a lot of good rounds last year against the right opposition to build him up to this level. And he's ready for HBO. And I think he's going to make a big, big splash. And I think that this fight against Velez, just because of the style matchup, is going to steal the show. It's going to be better than the main event, which, you know, probably isn't saying much. But Jason Velez, he took his first loss against Ronnie Rios in November on that Cotto Canelo undercard. And he put up again a good fight against Ronnie. He got marked up. He ate some leather, but he gave some back. Has the right kind of style for Joseph Diaz, where I think he's going to force Diaz to work. He's going to make Diaz learn a little bit on the job early on. Velez has been in there with, I think, better pro opposition. And that experience, he's going to push Joseph Diaz. And we're going to see Diaz make adjustments in there. The early rounds will be competitive, but I think that we're going to see Diaz push on the gas late. And I think it's very, very possible that even though he's not a very big power puncher, maybe he can score a stoppage late. He definitely wants to make an impression. That's definitely in the mind of him and his camp. And maybe an accumulation type of knockout, something like that, a corner stoppage. I don't know. Score that type of stoppage. I don't see a one-punch KO or something. But the accumulative effect. And Velez is a guy that has kind of cut and swelled up in the past. I've seen him at LA Fight Club too before he fought in that Cotto Canelo undercard. And he kind of swells up, his face gets puffy and stuff. So maybe, you know, maybe Diaz could cut him up or something like that. But for those of you who haven't seen Joseph Diaz Jr., he's 23 years old, 19-0, 11 KOs. Very, very good overall sound boxer. Was an Olympian, good amateur pedigree. He just seems poised to be one of the new faces of boxing in the lower weight divisions for the American fighters over the next few years. So make sure you check out the co-feature. But talking about the main event, look. When this fight was first announced, a lot of people on Twitter thought that this was going to be a possible upset. And there's still some people out there picking Barrera by upset. I don't think that's going to happen. I think that this is going to look a lot like the Ward-Frotch fight in 2011. I just think style-wise, Barrera is going to bring it. He's a strong, full, light heavyweight. But he's just not as fast as Ward. Ward has faster hands. Ward has much faster feet. The jab that Barrera brings back is real slow. He jabs, he brings it back real slow. And I think Ward's going to counterpunch the shit out of him. I also think Ward's going to try to hold him, tie him up. What's going to be interesting to see is if Barrera tries to fight off Ward when he tries that dirty stuff, right? The referee is going to do him absolutely no favors. It's in Ward's backyard. It's in a very controlled situation for Andre. That's pretty much how he fights. It's how he makes his deals. So Barrera is going to have to get nasty at times. No way he's winning a damn fight in the cards. So if that means, look, if Andre's headbutting you, you headbutt him back. If he's elbowing you, you elbow him back. You get nasty with him. You kind of got to pull a Marcos Maidana to Floyd Mayweather in their first fight. And you got to hope that the referee does the right thing, and he either lets the guys fight it out or he equally penalizes and warns both fighters. Which, you know, again, we saw in that first Mayweather-Maidana fight, we did not see in the rematch. So that's kind of the fight that Barrera needs to bring to him. Now, depending on what we see from Andre Ward here, it's going to give us a better indication as to how he's going to look against Sergey Kovalev. But we can't read too much into it because Sullivan Barrera fights absolutely nothing like Sergey Kovalev. It is interesting because Barrera, this is a massive leap in opposition for him as a pro, but he had a pretty good amateur career. He saw a bunch of different styles and everything. He's also been working with Abel Sanchez, who you know, is very, very good at teaching fighters how to cut off the ring, how to get the most leverage in your punches, how to hurt guys to the body. So it'll be interesting to see if Barrera can slow Ward down late in a fight, you know. Early on, I think this is going to be really, really ugly. Just ugly, ugly, ugly fight. I don't see this being very exciting at all. But the silver lining is maybe later in the fight, if Barrera just doesn't break down, you know, mentally and think, oh, I can't win, this sucks, the ref's against me, he's cheating, blah, blah. You know, if he starts pouting, then we'll just turn off the TV. But if he stays in the fight and really keeps trying to win until the 12th round, I think this might get a little interesting late. All that being said, Andre Ward wins a fairly dominant decision here, 9-3, somewhere in that realm. And look, this is possibly his best opponent since Karl Frotch, which was in 2011, right? That's kind of sad in a lot of ways. But look, if he really does get in the ring against Sergey Kovalev, and Kovalev's people at Main Events have already said they're going to Russia this summer, stay busy fight, but they're targeting November for the Kovalev-Ward fight. If that fight happens this year, it really, really happens, then all is forgiven. But we'll see, guys. Let me know what you think. Comment, like, share, subscribe. You know the deal. And I'll see you guys at the fights.